Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. Glad you all could make it out this morning. And looks like it's going to clear off a little bit and be a pretty nice day today. And we're really glad you came amidst all the different things that are going on right now. And so I invite you to stand and worship with us this morning.
Stripped away. me see you face to face, knowledge of your love as you live in me. And Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the in the power of your love, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love.
Heavenly Father, thank you this morning that we can stand in the power of your love, and we can just stand in your presence, and that if we wait on you and we just reach our arms out to you, that you will pick us up and carry us, and that you will just help us to soar as wings on eagles, as a promise in your word. And we just thank you for that this morning.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever, for he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. The mighty and setting sun. His love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful.
Heavenly Father, thank you that your love is as strong and endures forever. We just praise you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated for the devotional time.
I too want to welcome you. Service has changed a little bit this morning because of all the things that are going on, but I'm glad that each of you that did come are here today, and maybe we have differences in opinion on how to approach a time like this, but we can all respect each other's opinions, and we can still be here to worship God, and the ones that are not here because of sicknesses or out of concerns about the sicknesses can worship God at home. I'm going to be reading from Matthew chapter 18 for our devotional, and the sermon is about reaching the lost people, or the lost sheep, here in Matthew chapter 18, starting in verse 10. It is something that is, I think, very important to us as Christians. It was very important to Jesus when he was here. He said that's why he came, was to reach the lost. So starting in verse 10 of chapter 18 in Matthew, "See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he not leave the 99 on the hills and go to look for the one that wandered off? And if he finds it, truly I tell you, he is happier about that one sheep than about 99 that did not wander off. In the same way, your Father in heaven is not willing that any of these little ones should perish." if you think about that, if you find something that you've lost, or that you find something that maybe you've been looking for that you didn't even have before, it makes you really happy. And that's a good reason, because when you find something that's good, that is good. And God is always looking for people that do not know him. He is looking to find ways to bring his message to them, and he will use us to do that. So we need to be open, and we need to be looking for ways that God wants to use us and can use us to reach the people around us. And it can be in a lot of different ways, and a lot of it can happen here at home. We don't have to be going to some other place just to allow God's love to come through us and to flow to the people around us. It's a way of allowing people to see God and to realize that there is something good to be found in God. In our Sunday school book that we're going through it, there are a few lessons about praying for the lost. I think prayer is probably, maybe you could say both, the least and the most that you can do in reaching the lost, because Jesus specifically said we need to pray for the lost, but it's also one of the things that you can do wherever you are, is to pray for the lost people. So I want to encourage you to choose people to pray for intentionally every day and to keep praying for them, to bring them to God so that they can be your brother or sister in Christ. You were found at one point, and I expect you are very thankful that you did find what you did find and that God found you too. So it's the same way for other people that still do not know God. Let's pray. God, I thank you for your word, for your message of hope, your message of life that you give to us through Jesus. Your grace makes it all possible because we are all sinners and we do not deserve life. But you love us and you desire to have us have a relationship with you. And there are many people that do not have this relationship, and it is your desire that they would come to know you. So God asks that you would use us to spread your message, to be your message bearers, and to seek out people that do not know you so that we can do your work and to be a part of your plan of salvation. God asks you to be with Pastor Sherman as he brings this message today. Give him words that will take root in our hearts and will give us a desire to do your work, to go find people that need you and don't know you. God, I ask that you would be with each one that is here this morning and for those that chose not to come this morning or could not come this morning. I ask that you would have your blessings poured out on them, that you would protect each one. God, we trust you, and in times of fear, we know that you are still God, and we do not need to fear what the devil brings our way. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And we'll continue with our time of worship. It's just another change in our service.
I invite you all to stay in the game with me, please. Yet to see.
the full release of your promise, the church in victory. Turn to us, Lord, and touch us. Make us strong in your might. Overcome our weakness, that we could stand up and fight. Let your glory gather to seek your face. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Let us see on earth the glory of your nations. Let your fragrance rest in this place as we gather to seek your face. As we gather to seek your face.
Dear Lord, we just thank you so much that we can come here and that your spirit is resting upon us this morning. And we know that there's a lot going on in the world and there's a lot of fear and there's a lot of people who don't know what's next and don't know what eternity holds. And I just pray that as Christians, we wouldn't be afraid of these times, that we would go forth strong and bold and share your love and share your grace and your willingness to come and reach into people's lives to others this morning. And just thank you that because of what you've done for us, we can reach out to others with that same love. And just praise you this morning.
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. Every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of grateful wine. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, it's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Above All the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns.
It's all God's children singing glory.
Just heard. Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. All God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. All God's children singing glory.
Sickness, over sin, over anything in this world that would come against each of us, and you, that you stand behind us and you go before us. And we thank you, Lord, for your love, and we just pray a blessing over Pastor Sherman as he brings the message this morning. Pray that he would be empty of himself, and that he would just allow himself to be used for you, and that you would speak through him, and that you would touch our hearts this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
It's been a little bit of an unusual week, but it's good to see you here this morning, and it's always good to worship our God, our Father, our King, our Redeemer. And as we worship Him, He often changes our perspectives of how we see the circumstances that we deal with in life. I believe we have Children's Church this morning. Is that still on? Okay, that's still on. So at this time, the children can be dismissed to continue worshiping downstairs. And as the children are headed downstairs, I invite you too to turn to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Thanks, God, that we can come this morning and that we can worship you. Thank you that you are in your throne, that you are worthy of our worship, and that we can worship you now and too in all eternity. And thank you that, yeah, in the midst of life and unexpected circumstances, that you are in your throne and that you reign, and that you are surprised by nothing, and that you will always be sovereign, and that we can always worship you and look to you. Thank you for the empowerment of your Spirit. Pray that we would be in connection with you this morning, and that we would hear from your word through your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm curious, does the name Marvin Plank ring a bell for anyone? Does anybody know a Marvin Plank? Okay, no. Well, in 1915, he was 2.5 years old, so I suppose some of you it's possible to have known him, but in 1915, as a 2.5-year-old child, he wandered off. They had gone on a hike that day with his family, and they came back, and then later on, he, I guess, maybe wanted to go explore again or something, and he wandered off, and unfortunately, they weren't able to find him, certainly, right away. And, yeah, how would you like, and we certainly have things that we're concerned about in the world we live in today, but how would you like as a parent to have a 2.5-year-old lost somewhere? It wouldn't be a good feeling. And so he was lost in the mountain. He probably lived just a couple miles from here and next to the mountain somewhere. And as it got dark and they realized that they couldn't find him, they had a search party, and there was around 250 people that came between Airydale and between Belleville, and they got out lanterns, and they searched the mountain all night for him, and they couldn't find him. And so in the morning, they decided, well, we're going to send another search party up to the flat. Maybe he's up in the flat. And so they went up in the flat, and sure enough, they saw him walking down the road when they went up on the flat. And I'm sure his parents rejoiced to see him, and later, when he was asked where he slept that night, he said, oh, under the bushes, and didn't seem too concerned about it. But anyway, Leon this morning, too, read a story about a lost sheep. And just as a parent values their lost 2.5-year-old child, God values lost people. God values lost sheep. And so, and Jesus tells many stories, too. And through Scripture, we know that God values lost people. And I invite you to turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 15. And there's actually three stories told in Luke 15 about something that's lost: a lost sheep, a lost coin, and a lost son. But this morning we'll focus on the story of the lost sheep. And we'll go ahead and read the first 7 verses here of Luke chapter 15. So Luke 15, starting at verse 1. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners, and he eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable: "Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, 'Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep.' I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent." So I'd like to draw your attention there to verses 1 and 2, and just to the context of this story and all of the three stories that Jesus teaches in Luke 15. And in this context, we see that some people weren't happy with Jesus. Specifically, it says the tax collectors and the sinners, again, were gathering around to hear Jesus. Jesus was, as we know from other passages, he was eating with them, he was interacting with them. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law didn't think too highly of that. And so they said, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." And so this was an accusation against Jesus, that Jesus was hanging out with a shady crowd. You know, in today's culture, maybe if Jesus came today, maybe he would go to a bar, or, I don't know, go somewhere where people would say, question him for where he was going and for who he was spending his time with. But Jesus then, again, in order to explain why he hangs out with the people he hangs out with, why he spends time with who he spends time with, in order to explain that, he tells these three stories. And again, his first story is this parable of the lost sheep. And, you know, when I was at pastor's conference this last a little bit, Nick Ripken also taught on this parable. The theme, too, of pastor's conference was urgency as well. And in telling this story, Nick Ripken shared that he served in Africa for a number of years, and when he was in Africa, he would spend some time teaching with nomadic people on the dirt floor in a hut with people who were shepherds or people who had cows and camels and all kinds of herds. And when he told this story, the people sometimes commented, "This doesn't make sense. And he's like, what do you mean it doesn't make sense? Jesus told it has to make sense. But they said, you know, the story really doesn't make sense. They said, if we did something like that, if one of us did something like that, they might be killed. If they left 99 sheep or 99 cows or 99 camels to try and find one, why would you jeopardize the sake of the 99 to go look for the one that's missing? And they said, if somebody did that in our village, we might kill them. Or we would at least beat them and teach them a lesson not to do it again. And so when Jesus told this story, he told it too in a setting where there were lots of shepherds, and they would have understood too in some ways that, yeah, that it doesn't really make sense. And the original audience would have understood that more fully than we do. But we see, too, in Scripture, here's one example from Scripture. When David went down, this is from 1 Samuel 17, when David ends up fighting Goliath, and his father actually tells him to leave the sheep, and he does provide another shepherd to watch the sheep while David leaves the sheep, to go and to give his brother some food and to find out what's going on. And when he gets down there, one of his brothers, his oldest brother, isn't too happy with him, and he accuses him of having bad motivation. And he also says, with whom did you leave the few sheep in the wilderness? So that certainly was a concern, to leave sheep unguarded in the wilderness. And in this story that Jesus tells too, it is a picture of the sheep being left in open country, it says here in verse 4. And that really is wilderness. They weren't left in a barn. They weren't left in a meadow with the fence around it. They were left in open country. They were left in wilderness. And it would have been a risk to the rest of the flock to leave them. And apparently, at times, too, they did just have one shepherd watching a whole flock of sheep. And in this case, too, David, assumedly, was the only one watching these flock of sheep that his brothers were concerned about. And so, whenever we look at parables, parables have one main lesson, normally. And so, we can't try and use a parable and in a sense, every illustration breaks down. So we can't use this parable to say that we shouldn't care for the 99. That's not the main point of the parable. The main point of this story isn't, are the 99 worthy to care for? The main point of this story is how important it is to look for lost sheep and how much God values lost sheep. God values that one lost sheep in a sense, as much as he values the 99 who are safe in the meadow, who are safe and taken care of. And so God wants us, too, to have that kind of radical mentality to care for lost people, that we would value lost people just as much and that we would be willing to take risk, too. Certainly the shepherd took a risk here in leaving the 99 sheep to go find the one that was lost. And we also are invited and called and challenged to take risks, whatever that may be, to associate with people that maybe we don't feel safe associating with or whatever. But God wants us to make it a priority to certainly connect with lost people. And we live in a beautiful valley and a beautiful area, and we don't always maybe see as much need as some places if we lived in the middle of an urban area or some other place like that. But there certainly are lost sheep in our community and regionally as well, and obviously around the world. And God wants us to value reaching lost sheep, whether it be local, regional, or around the world. And he wants us as a church, too, to certainly, as individuals, we need to be concerned, but as a church, too, we need to be concerned and continue to process how we can connect with and reach lost sheep. And in this story, we also see certainly the great love and celebration and joy that comes from finding lost sheep. One of life's greatest joys involves seeing lost people come home, and whether it be a literal physical sense like Marvin Plank, but certainly spiritually, you know, and for Marvin Plank, that affected the rest of his life on earth. And when we reach lost people and help them find their eternal homes, that affects the rest of their eternal destiny. And so that's a huge opportunity and a huge, as I said, opportunity that we can reach out and connect and hopefully point people to Jesus and point people home. So God wants us to live again with that same kind of urgency and to form rescue parties and to attempt to look and point lost people to Jesus. And it's certainly by God's grace that we do that. In some ways, it's easier to find a physical person who's missing in the mountain than it is to find lost sheep or a lost person. Lost people have a will. They don't always know that they're lost. You know, a two-year-old kid, you find them, you just pick them up and you take them home. Somebody who is lost in a spiritual level, you don't just pick them up and take them to Jesus. In a sense, you can try that, but they have to be willing to go. They have to be willing to be pointed to Jesus. And so it involves certainly God's grace and empowerment in reaching lost people. And in living with urgency, you know, you can live with urgency and have the urgency of seeing a physical person being missing, and that creates a lot of urgency. But we need to be reminded of the urgency, too, of lost people. And if we don't believe that people are lost, we won't have mission. We won't have a sense of urgency. So we have to know and acknowledge that there are indeed lost people. And it's because there are lost people. And Jesus taught more, actually, about hell, too, than he did about heaven, to remind us that, yes, this is a reality. And we do need to be concerned about the condition of other people, and to certainly be motivated too by love in connecting with lost people. And as lost people come to Jesus, that is a wonderful thing to celebrate, and we have joy in that. And in the same way that Marvin Plank's parents celebrated his return home, there is a celebration in heaven, and we see that down in verses 5 and through 7 here of Luke 15. And throughout the rest of the parable, Jesus says the same kind of thing too, whether it's the lost coin or the lost son, that there's much rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents. And then verse 7, it says, I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. So it's a wonderful thing to be in a right relationship with God and to follow him and hear his voice. But it's a wonderful thing, too, to engage in connecting with lost people and leading lost people home. And I think, too, we need to be challenged in our level of passion and concern for lost people. I've heard stories about certainly other evangelists who have wept over lost people. I know D.L. Moody reportedly wept, or tears would come to his eyes whenever he would think of lost people. And he came to Christ when he moved to Boston. And he had a Sunday school teacher who came to visit him where he was working, and he knew his Sunday school teacher was weeping for his soul. And he said, why are you weeping for my soul? I'm not weeping for my soul. Why are you weeping for my soul? And eventually, he came to Christ through his Sunday school teacher. But we certainly, and myself included, need to continue to care that much for lost people that we would weep. It's a wonderful thing that we can experience the grace of God. But God also wants us to share that grace with other people and not just hold it to ourselves. And Jesus is both our teacher and our example in living with intentionality in pursuing lost people. In Luke 19:10, Jesus said, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." So that was one of his primary purposes for coming. Ultimately, it was through the cross that we can get back to Jesus. And the cross provides that bridge back to God that covers that canon between us and God that we could never fulfill and cross on our own. But Jesus, while he was here, not only did he certainly die on the cross, but the way he lived and the way he interacted with people, we see his concern, again, for those who were far from him. And I invite you to turn over to Mark 2, 15 through 17, and we'll, again, just see another passage that gives an example of how Jesus connected with lost people. That's Mark chapter 2, and we'll read verse 15 through verse 17. Mark 2, starting at Verse 15, while Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. So again, we see Jesus teaches about the urgency of reaching lost people, but he also lived the urgency of reaching lost people. And he ate with people in society who would have been looked down on. And in Jewish culture, it definitely was a society in some ways of judgment and of different social strata. And even in England, we know in the 1800s, 1700s, you look, and if you were in certain classes, you weren't typically trying to associate with other classes. You certainly wouldn't marry across class. But in this New Testament world, too, to reach out and connect with tax collectors and sinners, it would have been crossing social boundaries that would have challenged people's assumptions and their cultural norms. But Jesus challenges our cultural norms. He challenges our assumptions that we make. And so what assumptions do we have that hinder us from connecting with other people, with lost people? And God does want us to value being holy. And so we hold that as well, that principle as well. But we can't allow the desire to be holy to separate us from lost people. The only way we can be salt and the only way we can be light is by connecting with darkness, by connecting with people who don't know Jesus. And so we are encouraged, challenged to not allow fear to hinder us from crossing boundaries and reaching out to people who are different from us and reaching out to people who desperately need Jesus. And as we attempt to live out God's heart, he'll open doors that often that we didn't see coming. You know, this last week, a couple of us went to State College and connected with a couple who's missionaries to international students. And Penn State has about 40,000 or so students, and around 9,000 of them are international students. And a lot of them come from unchurched backgrounds, come from China or Muslim backgrounds or whatever. And this couple was working full time in reaching out and connecting with international students. And they've kind of said some opportunities that we could engage too in hosting international students over Easter or Thanksgiving or whatever, and connecting with them. And so, and that was a door that just kind of opened out of the blue. As we truly attempt to live out God's heart, he'll open doors that we can't open on our own. And so as we are faithful, we can trust that God, and by his grace, that he will give the empowerment that's needed to connect with people who are close to his heart. And this last couple of weeks, or January and February, we had a discipleship course in spiritual warfare, and through that course, too, it really focused on God's kingdom and the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. And one of the things we said was that in God's, God and Satan are at battle, and ultimately they have some of the same goals. They want their kingdoms to grow, and whenever a lost person comes to Christ, they move from that kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, and that's a huge transition that someone can move from that kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, and whenever they do that, Satan's kingdom is diminished and God's kingdom grows. And so certainly, as we know with spiritual warfare, as we reach out to lost people, that is one of the ways we deal with evil and combat evil, is to invite people to Jesus and into a kingdom of light and healing where they can have true hope and freedom. And unless people experience that freedom from that kingdom of darkness, we haven't really done much to help them. So as we seek to help people, we need to point them to Jesus. And as they come to him, they can experience true hope and new life. Now, some of you have probably started reading the book, The Insanity of God. Here's one quote from there that fits in with what we're talking about. What is Satan's paramount intent? Quite simply, it is this: denying the world access to Jesus. Satan's greatest desire is for the people of this planet to leave Jesus alone. Satan desires that we turn away from Jesus, or that we never find him in the first place. If Satan cannot be successful at that, he desires to keep believers quiet, to diminish or silence our witness, and to stop us from bringing others to Christ. It is that simple. Believers who do not share their faith aid and abet Satan's ultimate goal of denying others access to Jesus. And so he's basically saying that in persecution, one of the goals of the persecutors is to keep people quiet and to keep believers quiet and stop sharing their faith so that more people don't come to Jesus. And while we are in a setting and an environment where our lives aren't threatened if we share Jesus, if we are quiet, in a sense, the same thing is happening as if we were persecuted and decided to be quiet. And so Satan desires for us certainly not to share Jesus. And ultimately, I think that shouldn't be our motivation. Our motivation should be positive and should be out of love and grace to share Jesus, and we shouldn't be motivated by that guilt. But I think it's helpful to realize that big picture of the spiritual battle we're in and the big picture of how we can overcome darkness by sharing Jesus. And this is it's another quote from The Insanity of Obedience, which is a follow-up book to The Insanity of God. Choosing Jesus as Lord and Savior and then sharing his love and grace with others is the clearest way to stand against and oppose evil. So if we want to stand against and oppose evil, we can certainly not only embrace God's grace ourselves, but we can also share God's grace and love with other people. And as we do that, we will combat darkness and we will combat evil. And so as a leadership team, as we've been talking about building, we've also been talking about how does this fit in with the big picture of what God is calling us to do. And so we have articulated or wrote down some long and short-term goals, and those were placed in your mailbox in your mailboxes this morning. And certainly one of those long-term goals ties in with reaching lost people. And that's really the first goal that is on the papers in your mailboxes, and maybe some of you have in front of you. But one long-term and short-term goal is conversion growth. We're reaching people for Jesus. Should be one of our driving purposes. Conversion growth is part of God's general will for all churches. We can pray and seek God's will over specific situations, and that's fine and good. But we do know a lot of God's general will just from Scripture. And we do know that just from even the verses we read this morning, that reaching lost people matters dearly to God and to His heart. And so God wants us to not just talk about it, but to embrace that in how we live our lives as individuals, and to embrace that in how we live our lives as a church. And when we send people to Spain or Belarus or whatever, you expect them to reach out and try and reach people for Jesus and to think like missionaries. But increasingly, churches are becoming more and more aware, and especially in recent years, that God wants us to think like missionaries where we're at. It's not good enough to send people to Spain or wherever, and that's wonderful to do that, but God wants us to think like missionaries here. Every day, and to be a missionary here, and to be concerned about lost people ourselves, and not just give money to other people who their job is to reach people for Jesus. God wants us to internalize that as certainly as individuals and as a congregation. So how do we do that moving forward? And I think we'll continue to pray and process what that can look like, and we'll talk about some application a little later on. But one form of application, too, would be to move in the direction of being more a community church or more of a missional church, and it says that, too, on your paper. Churches often lean towards being a traditional church or a community church, with some congregations being a mix of the two. Community churches in our culture are more likely to grow through conversion growth than traditional churches. Why? Many unchurched people in our culture tend to connect better with worship settings that are less traditional. And even as the building committee went around and visited other churches, one of the things that we heard back is many of the churches that were building were, in a sense, trying to make their churches less churchy or feel less churchy. And if You want people to come in from the outside who've never been to church before. How does that affect how you do church? And so that can affect your building. It can certainly affect how you do everything. But in general, and I'm sure, and there are many traditional churches where there's certainly good people, and where there's a lot of mission happening as well. But a lot of times in traditional churches, the focus is for the mission to happen somewhere else. But in a community church, it really is recognizing and embracing that, yes, mission can happen here too, and that God wants mission to happen here in our local community as well as in our global and other community and broader community. I'd like to look at just one scripture here from 1 Corinthians 9 that speaks into this, and this is Paul writing, and Paul himself was called really and personally to reach people for Jesus. But we all are, at some level or another, whether we have that as our main wiring or not. But we see that Paul and how he lived his life and in what he said even here in Corinthians, he describes how he tried to reach the lost people. And the message shouldn't change, but the way we present it or the way we connect with people should change depending on who we're trying to reach. And that's basically what this passage says. And though I am free and belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew. And he mentions a number of different kind of groups of people, and those are underlined here. To the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I've become all things to all people, so that by all possible means I might save some. And so as our culture that we live in changes, we need to reevaluate how we connect with lost people. Years ago, you could have revival services, and people would come from the community, and people would come to Christ. You read even for Allensville back in the 40s and the 50s. People were coming to Christ, too, even through, you know, tent services, tent revivals. When's the last time you've had a tent revival? Was it any ever in the 70s even? Maybe the 60s, I don't know. But we certainly don't think we're going to put a tent up across the field anytime soon. Times change, and so we need to change with times as well and do whatever it takes to adapt and to connect with people where they're at. So that's what we are invited to, and invite you to continue to be part of that process and to think through how we can connect with our culture and connect with people as we live in a changing world. And there's a number of other, I think I may skip over this slide, but God does call us to focus on those outside our four walls, and that should be a common purpose that impacts all of our ministry teams, not just the local, regional, a mission team, or a couple individuals. So again, for whatever ministry you're part of, or maybe you're not officially part of a ministry at AMC, but if you are part of a ministry team, then that should be the purpose of your ministry team too, should be focusing on reaching lost people, whether it's worship or discipleship or whatever. There's also overlap between really all areas of our purpose, but God does invite each area to focus on this goal of connecting with lost people. And certainly as individuals too, we need to, doesn't have to be a formal meeting and thing that happens, but as individuals, we can continue to seek to live missionally, to seek to live with urgency and to reach out to people and bringing people, lost people home. And so, I encourage you to continue to pray and process how that might look like for who you are and however God may have wired and gifted you. And so along those lines, another long and short-term goal for AMC involves AMC to continue to becoming more of a community church and less of a traditional church. And there has been change, I think, over the years, certainly in that direction. And one of the things that we've asked, too, is there any ways of speeding that up? And those are things that we can continue to pray and process. But if God's going to do something new, he often requires a new wineskin. And so perhaps a new building could be a new wineskin, and that ties in with our next long and short-term goal, too, is to update our buildings to better facilitate ministry to those inside and outside our four walls. The church is ultimately about people, the people here. But the building of any church is also a tool that we can use in connecting with people. And so we'll continue to pray and continue to evaluate and to process how we can continue to adjust buildings and update buildings in a way that can most effectively minister to people here, but also how can we minister through our building to people outside as well. You all have a voice here. You all can speak up and say, I don't like what you're doing, or I like what you're doing. But the people outside who don't know Christ don't have a voice at the table in this discussion. But we need to be concerned about them as well, and imagine that if they were sitting here, what would they say? And how can we also process building as we move forward in a way that their voice matters and that their eternal destiny matters? And lastly, one long and short-term goal for AMC involves reproducing or contributing to reproducing new churches. And we've talked about that and processed that in the past. And we had kind of a report that we came up with that included some short and long-term goals of doing that. And we said that, and in your paper, there are some short-term goals listed and focus on things like giving percentages of our missions budget to those who are involved in church planning and so on. But if we value reaching lost people, we should value church planning. Church planning is the most effective way to reach people for Jesus in our culture. And so as we process long-term and short-term, we can continue to pray about that and to pray about whatever steps we can do, whether we ourselves directly plant a church or whether we contribute to it, whatever. But God wants us to have a heart and care about lost people and also care about giving people the gift of His bride, the gift of His body. And so by God's grace, we can do those things. And it does take His grace. We can't carry out ministry alone on our own. And I would like to just share a couple applications here, or things to think about as we move forward. And one of those would be inviting Sunday school classes. I think at Allensville, we really, in some ways, are 8 or 9 little mini congregations. Our Sunday school classes are well attended, which is a wonderful thing, and there's a lot of care that happens in our Sunday school classes and fellowship that happens there. But I know, yeah, even the discipleship team was processing small groups, and one of the things that we were discussing too and were reading about was that, you know, even every small group should have a mission. And I think it's healthy for every Sunday school class to have a mission. It's nice to meet for fellowship, but every Sunday school class too can be encouraged or should think about and process and invited to think about a specific local mission that you can be involved in as a Sunday school class. And that will, as you engage in mission, that does build community. But every healthy church is engaged in mission. And so if our Sunday school classes are like little mini congregations, it'd be a wonderful thing to see each Sunday school class too embrace ways that they can connect with the mission or ministry. And you know, the local regional missions team has talked about that before, and things like really ever got off the ground, but would invite each class to continue to process that, and at some point the local team may come around and have a conversation as well. But it's a wonderful thing too when ideas come from the bottom up. It's one of the ways or one of the reasons we started team-based ministry, was that so ideas come from the bottom up as well. And while we do have ministry teams that, Lord willing, come up with ideas and ways of connecting with people, if we all are concerned about reaching lost people, hopefully things will come from the bottom up as well, and not just as a part of a formal, organized church thing. So, by God's grace, may we continue to focus on reaching lost people, and we are having a meeting, as our meeting is scheduled April the 1st for the local regional missions team here at the church building. And so if you do want to be part of something that is a formal group, you can come to that too and share ideas and connect with that. So you can think about that. So then in this document, the next slide has the AMC vision, which lists, you see the cross in the middle, which represents Jesus. We want to be cross-centered. We want to be focused on Christ in all that we do. But then you can see the word come, grow, love, and go. And those vision also ties in with our purpose. And again, you have a document in your mailbox about that this morning. But we need to come worship Jesus. And all these areas are important. It's not just mission. But if we worship, if we grow, if we love, and we stop there, we haven't really carried out God's heart. God wants us to do worship. He wants us to engage in worship. He wants us to grow, to focus on discipleship. God wants us to love, to focus on community. That's wonderful, and we should focus and put energy into those things. But again, if we stop there, we haven't carried out God's heart. God wants us to keep going and to get to the go part. And as we live life, to take the world to the world. These last 4 years, we focused on each one of those themes. And again, each one is important. And if you do anything to contribute to any of those things, that's significant. God, again, desires us to focus on having the heart and following the example of Jesus and to reach out and to point lost people home. And so encourage you to continue to pray and process how you can do that as individuals and continue to pray and process as a church, how we can do that together as well. I'd like to just end with two quotes this morning from a book called The Externally Focused Church. Worship, teaching, and personal devotions are absolutely necessary for building the internal capacity necessary to sustain an external focus. But if all the human and financial resources are expended inside the four walls of the church, then no matter how spiritual things may appear to be, something is missing. So again, to embrace God's heart, we need to do all of those things. Externally focused churches are internally strong. Internal stuff matters. But they are oriented externally. These churches look for ways to use their communities to be a part of their hopes and dreams. They build bridges to their communities instead of walls around themselves. They don't shout at the dirty stream. They get in the water and they begin to clean it up. So yes, reaching lost people involves risks. Yes, it can be messy, but God calls us to seek to build relationships with lost people and to seek as a congregation to make it a priority to point lost people home. So as individuals and as a congregation, may we follow the teaching and the example of Jesus, who built bridges into the lives of lost people. He calls us to do the same thing. And as we do that, may we point lost people home by God's grace. Thanks, God, that by your grace we can know you, that we can have peace in our hearts, and that we can also share that peace and share that grace with other people. And pray, Lord, that as a congregation and as individuals, that we would continue to process and live out your heart. Thank you again for the depth of your love for us, and thank you for how richly you've blessed us in Christ. And pray, Lord, again, that we would be not a reservoir of blessing, but we would be that channel of blessing where your blessing would flow up through us to our community here in Big Valley and regionally and all around the world. And so thank you for your grace, and thank you for your gifts and your spirit and your presence, which empower us to fulfill the calling that you've given us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before we go ahead and start singing, the song is number 538 in the Mennonite hymnal, and I don't know if it's going to be up there or not, and it's okay if it's not. But as Pastor Sherman was talking, God kind of laid on my heart, one of the cool things about being part of the hymn side of the music ministry and the contemporary side of the music ministry is seeing how the songs that we sing in the hymn time and the songs that we sing in the contemporary worship time are different, and there's different music and there's instruments, and I mean, you can have instruments with hymns, but one of the cool things is that, especially in this hymn, is the love of God, the message never changes. We sang a lot about love in the first half of the service, and as we sing this song too, we're talking about the love of God and how great it is. And as we start to think about how, as a body of believers, how we can start reaching out to the lost a little bit better in our world, I just think it's really cool that even the people back in early 1900s, 1800s, way back when hymns were being written, that they had the same mission and the same idea, just the delivery is a little different. And so that's one of the cool things I love about being a part of both music ministries, and it's just kind of some food for thought that I had this morning. So now you guys can stand. Number 538 in the Mennonite hymnal.
Welcome to this worship service of Jesus Christ. And if you are visiting here this morning, we are glad that you are here with us. And so, again, thanks for coming. We come together as a community of believers to share life together on Sunday mornings, but we also meet at other times. And one of those times is here this afternoon. This afternoon, we are welcome to gather at the Huntington or the Holiday Bowl in Huntington at 3:30. I think there was an author called Robert Putman or Pullman who wrote a book entitled Bowling Alone. Well, this afternoon, we are not bowling alone. We get a chance to bowl together with one another. And so we have that to look forward to. A message and just a few things from the prayer team. As a faith community, we also come together to pray with one another. The prayer team is coming up with times in which we can pray with one another, and one of these times is before the Sunday morning services. Also, there's a Saturday morning on April 4th. As a community, we are also experiencing 40 days, a 40-day journey called Love to Pray. The prayer team is inviting us to share during sharing times ways that we are experiencing newness in our relationship with God through prayer. And so during the next Sundays, during sharing times, we are invited to share our experiences with one another. Has been mentioned this past week, the governor of Pennsylvania, as well as other various health officials, both state and national, have made decisions that have impacted the way that we live. For those involved in education, as students or employees, for the next 2 weeks, the decision will be especially felt. In addition, these decisions are impacting the faith communities and our community as well. And here are some of the ways that I know about. Over at State College, Saturday's singing and song leading school, we received this notice at the church office, as well as the community game night this Thursday. And then coming closer home in conversation with Don Showalter and a number of people yesterday, the decision has been made that it would be best to postpone our renewal services and the fellowship meal that was scheduled for next weekend, to postpone them in the fall. As well as we've, in the church office, been notified that the Rosedale Corral, because RBC is closing or is not, is altering their schedule canceling their corral program, they will not be here as well. This week, we do not need to respond out of fear, but rather in the community of believers, we can serve one another in confidence of knowing that God is in control, and we can be obedient and follow the guidelines of those in the state level as well as the local. Our community has a rich history. It has a rich history. One of the people of our community who has not been in attendance due to health, geography distance, as well as other reasons, is Martha Byler. Martha's funeral service will be held here tomorrow morning. It will be a smaller service, from 10 to 11 is visitation, and then there's a service at 11 o'clock here, and then the graveside following. And so let's be in prayer for the extended family and friends of Martha. Also, the building offering or the building fund contributions may be placed in the offering plate over the next weeks. Just a reminder, here We are not receiving the offering through the typical way of passing plates, but they will be placed at either of the back door and the front door. What prayer and things would you like to share here this morning as we continue to remember those who are impacted locally as well as around the world by the COVID-19 virus?
This is Donna. Just an update on the bowling. We do plan to go. I talked with the bowling alley at this point. They are open. If any of you that signed up have decided you wish not to go, that's okay. I would appreciate if you would let me know. Also, those of you going, you are welcome to bring snacks to share. Bottles of water will be provided. You can also buy things there. So plan to see you this afternoon at 3:30. Again, just a reminder, $4 per person. Church will pay the difference. Thank you.
This is Gloria. I received a couple messages from Aretha yesterday and then this morning, just so we can, how we can be praying for them in Spain. They are, as of this morning, on a total lockdown for the next 15 days. So that will also affect Pablo and Rosa. Only trips out will be for groceries. Work and travel to care for those in need are allowed. And an interesting exception, she said, is that you're allowed to go out and walk your dog. They're glad to be living on the plantation. Allows them to get out and walk around and without meeting people. They had planned to meet with the owner of the building that the church is meeting in next Sunday, but that's not going to happen. But she's very eager to sell, and so they're hoping that with all the economy and everything happening, that this might be actually a benefit for the church. So they ask us to be praying for that also. Thanks.
This is Rose. Many of you have been asking how Dad made out. He did have his aorta valve replaced a week ago on Thursday to find out that his heart rate wasn't going to come up. So he consented to have a pacemaker put in on Friday morning, which doubled his heart rate. Came home Saturday, couldn't even walk until this morning. A week has been good. He came out walking out the hall without even his cane this morning. So we're praising Jesus for that. He is feeling really good. And also, at his request, Chris and I are making the transition of moving in permanently with him. So it's going well. There's just a lot needs to be done. So thank you for your prayers. And yeah, just continue. We'll get through it.
Just to draw your attention to the announcement in the bulletin regarding the beacon, which will no longer be distributed in the format that you're used to. We are encouraging that you receive it via email, but if you're not able to get it that way or would prefer to have a printed copy from the church placed in your mailbox, there is a sign-up sheet by the mailboxes to get it that way. Thank you.
Okay, I thank you very much. We as a faith community are also remembering this week the Bevels family, and Chris pulls our attention to Isaiah 55:11. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth, it shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. Let's enter into a time of prayer. I'll first of all give you the opportunity to pray, and then I'll close with an audible prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, you tell us in your word that our prayers and our times of communication with you is like an aroma, is like incense being offered, and that you collect, you receive them. We're also told in scripture that that your son Jesus Christ is sitting on your right hand, interceding on our behalf. We're also told in scripture, God, that your Holy Spirit is taking that which we cannot even utter, either emotionally or for other reasons, and is bringing these requests. And so, God, thank you for this time of meeting together with brothers and sisters in that confidence, knowing that our times of communication with you, both speaking and listening to you, can be rich, rich times of drawing together with one another, as well as drawing near to you. And so receive these prayers that we have lifted up to your throne here this morning, and we do thank you for doing that. Thank you also for the opportunity that we have to worship you through the giving of our offerings and tithes, and we ask your blessing to be upon them here this morning as they are received at the doors of the sanctuary. And we do thank you that you are in control, and we pray for your peace to be pervasive throughout this valley and around the world, and that as believers of God Almighty, that we can wake up every morning with the knowledge and the confidence that comes from knowing that you are in control, and that we and the confidence and the hope of your love. And it's in the precious name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. This point, I think we have another song, and then the benediction.
Sing his last song. Just kind of everything we've been talking about this morning, and reaching the lost, and even talking about just some of the things going on with the coronavirus and different things going around. I just love this song, how important it is for us to remember that as we leave here, this is what should be our driving purpose and our why we go out into the world, and why we really live our lives, and what motivates us. So as we sing this song, I invite you to worship with us.
Cornerstone, sure foundation, you are faithful to the end. We are we are waiting.
the saving love of Christ.
Let's pray. Thanks, God, for the cross, and thank you for Jesus and the hope and the life that we have in you because of Jesus and because of the cross. Thanks, too, for the resurrection and the assurance that we have of resurrection because of the resurrection of Christ. And thank you that you do give strength in the midst of life and in the midst of all kinds of circumstances. And so we thank you for that, and we thank you that we can come and worship you this morning and that you are worthy of our worship. Thanks for this body, this group of people who follows you and who desires to follow you, and pray that again that our hearts would be in tune with your heart, and that you empower us in being like you, in worshiping you, and in reflecting your grace in the world we live in. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. And so at this time, any children who are remaining and the Shine youth too are invited to be dismissed, and after they are dismissed, and we will continue with Sunday school and with the video on prayer in a little bit.
Team. Alvin continues to lead Learning to Love to Pray seminars for churches in the United States, for Harvest Prayer Ministries, and as the prayer facilitator for his denomination's West Coast regional team. Alvin continues to lead Learning to Love to Pray seminars for churches in the United States and abroad. Alvin is a member of the National Prayer Committee and the Denominational Prayer Leaders Network.
This session is about claiming God's riches. Claiming God's riches is about petition. And I'm using the word petition in the way it is normally being used in the church world today, asking for ourselves. One of the most important insights God ever taught me about prayer had to do with petition, asking for ourselves. It happened when I was studying 1 John 5:14 and 15 some years ago. That's the passage which says, "This is the confidence we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, we know that we have what we've asked of him." And as I pondered that passage, I thought, if I can just be sure what is in accord with God's will, then I can ask with absolute certainty that I'll get what I ask for. This is kind of a guarantee. How do I know it's God's will? Then he brought me to Romans 8:29, which reminds us that it's God's will for every one of us to be conformed to the image of Christ. Would you agree? Yeah. So I did a very simple thing. I said, "Lord, conform me to the image of Christ." How do you suppose he answered that prayer? Can you imagine God saying no to that? And I prayed that day after day, and I began to see some things happening which were part of God's answer. So I thought, wow, this is good. I wonder what else I can ask that's in accord with God's will. The next thing he gave me was, "Lord, make me a man of prayer." Is that a prayer in accord with his will? Well, yeah, of course it is. There's no way, shape, or form God would say no to anybody who seriously comes to him and says, "Make me a person of prayer." And so I continued to pray that, and, well, I began to see some things going on. And then I started to add to my list, "Lord, make me a man of the word. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Help me to abide in you and you in me." All prayers in accord with God's will, right? And the kind of prayers to which he gives us a guaranteed yes answer. Now, I just want to start out by saying it is important for us to pray for ourselves, particularly when we're praying things that he wants us to have. And that's where we're going to launch in here. God wants us to ask for ourselves. Now, I don't mean in saying that he wants us to pray selfish prayers, getting creature comforts and abundance of earthly goods and living the affluent lifestyle and the prosperity gospel and all that. That's not the point. When I say God wants us to ask for ourselves, we're saying God wants us to ask for the things he wants us to have, the abundant life, peace and joy and fruitfulness in the Spirit and spiritual blessings and strength in our prayer lives. And he wants us to ask for these things, as Jesus made it so clear in Luke 11, verses 9 through 11, your passage I'm sure you know, "Ask and it will be given you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you." And then he goes through it again, "For everyone who asks receives, you seeks finds, he who knocks will have it open to him." He has so much to give that he wants us to ask so that he can give in response to our asking. In fact, he's even on the lookout for people. As we know from 2 Chronicles 16:9, eyes of the Lord roam to and fro throughout the earth to make himself strong in behalf of those whose hearts are right toward him. I really think that it's an insult to God, who's offered us so much, abundant spiritual blessings, everything that pertains to life and godliness, if we don't ask, and in asking demonstrate our willingness to receive and our dependence on him. The second thing to say is this: we must ask in order to receive. A problem in our church world so often is that we simply assume that because God is loving and generous, gracious, that he gives and gives and gives whether we ask or not. Now, he could, but he's chosen not to. He's decided he wants to give in response to our asking. A classic confession out of the Reformation period, the Heidelberg Catechism, puts it this way. It asks the question, why should we pray so unceasingly? And it answers by saying, because God gives his grace and his spirit only to those who unceasingly ask him for them. I think that hits the nail on the head. Matthew 7:11, Jesus says, comparing the giving of parents, earthly parents, to the giving of his heavenly Father. And he reminds us that when children ask for bread, we don't give stones. When they ask for fish, we don't give them a snake. And then he goes on to say, how much more will your Father in heaven give good things to those who ask? 16 times in the last instructions of Jesus to his disciples when he was here on earth, he challenges, urges, invites them to ask. I think he was pretty serious about this business of asking. And what if we don't ask? Well, James makes that clear. He was talking to Christians who were experiencing spiritual poverty. And he said, you know, the problem is this, you don't have because you don't ask. Asking is the divinely ordained means whereby God confers his blessings. And he wants us to understand our dependence on him. God especially wants us to ask for good things. We don't mind, do we, as those of us who have been or are parents, when our kids come and ask for candy or toys or things that they particularly like. And we sometimes treat them to those things, but isn't it really delightful when they ask for things we really want them to have? When they ask for us to teach them how to pray, to read the Bible with them, to build a relationship with a friend in school, or to work through some problem, the good things. And so it is with our Father in heaven. When Jesus said in Matthew 7 that we should ask for good things, when you look at Luke 11, verse 13, he had almost the same thing, but he put it this way. How much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? And because he said it twice, one saying give the good things and the other give the Holy Spirit, it's clear that Jesus was thinking that the good things were the things that the Holy Spirit gives us. And so when we ask, we can ask with the assurance, if we ask for good things, that he will give us those things. Another thing to say is that we get what we ask for when we ask in accord with God's will. And that means simply, as I suggested in that opening story, asking for the things he wants us to have. God kind of sealed that for me through a little experience. After I had begun to think this way, my son Don, who was 7 years old at the time, just learning to read, walked into my study and he said, Dad, can I have a Bible? I said, well, why do you want a Bible, son? He said, well, in Sunday school, we're beginning to learn verses, and I want to have my own Bible so I can mark them in my own Bible and I can always find them again. If you're parents, how would you answer a child who asked something like that? Well, it's a no-brainer. He had his Bible within 24 hours. But when we go to God and ask for the good things, when we ask for prayer and something to do with the Holy Spirit and the Word and joy and peace and fruit and all of those things, I think if we were listening, we'd hear him say, yeah, of course, I'm glad you asked. And initiate immediately through the Son and the Holy Spirit what it takes to deliver. So it's important for us to ask in accord with his will. My ask list is got so long, I couldn't remember them all anymore. So I used the alphabet and I put together an A to Z. And it's in the back of the Love to Pray book, you know. So almost every day I go through this list and I say, Lord, help me to abide in you and you and me. Is that according to his will? Yeah. Well, bless me with every spiritual blessing and conform me to the image of Christ and deliver me from the evil one and equip me with your Holy Spirit and forgive my sins, A, B, C. Create your own list and ask every day. But it's necessary to say that not all asking secures a positive response from God. There is a condition. He says we must ask in faith. Now, one of those good things that we can ask for is wisdom. Would you agree that's in accord with God's will? But in James 1, he says, if any of you lack wisdom, ask, and you know, God is going to give it to you. But you must ask in faith, for if you don't ask in faith, you'll be a double-minded person and you won't receive anything from the Lord. Asking in faith is asking with the absolute conviction that God will keep his word, that he always acts and responds out of his character. And knowing that, we can be absolutely sure when we ask in accord with his will that he will deliver. Now, our confidence, you see, the confidence John spoke about when he said, this is the confidence we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, is not a confidence that there's kind of a cause and effect relationship between asking in faith and receiving. It's not a confidence that this is a law of the universe. It's not a confidence that this is a formula we've got to live with somehow and can live with. It's a confidence in the person of God, that he always delivers on his promises. It's a personal promise. If we don't ask, then we fall into that category of those who will not receive. And there's a final condition that I want to mention also, or two, in fact. We must ask with clean hearts and obedient spirits. Again, from the Epistle of John, 1 John 3:21 and 22, we hear John saying this, we have confidence before our God and receive from him anything we ask. Oh, that sounds good. But then he goes on to say, because we obey his commands and do what pleases him. Obedience is fundamental to prayer. Only people who obey have a right to expect God to answer. And the final thing to say is we have to ask with right motives. And that, of course, comes from James 5, verse 4, verse 3. You ask and receive not, says James, to these impoverished Christians, who some of whom were still praying. You ask and receive not because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. What would right motives be? To ask that I can be more like Christ, right? To ask that I can glorify his name, to ask that I can advance his kingdom, do his will, witness to a friend. When we ask with those kind of motives, we expect him to answer with a yes. One way to get yourself into this way of praying is to ask yourself two questions when you're asking for these good things from the Lord, praying prayers of petition. One is to say, will this make me a better person for Christ? If God gives me what I'm asking, will it make me a better, more Christ-like person? And the second question to ask is, what will God get out of it if he answers me positively? See, if you're asking in accord with his will, it will make you a better person, and God will get the glory. Most of our prayers, I think, should be in accord with God's will. But when we pray, we don't always know what his will is, and when we don't know what his will is, and we're asking for those things which are sort of neutral, then we can ask with the assurance that in his love and by his wisdom, he will do what is best. Love always seeks the best. And so when we ask, he will give us what is best. And that usually means joy and peace and fruitfulness and so forth. But sometimes it means something not so pleasant. Paul asked for health, the Apostle Paul, and he got a thorn in the flesh. And God wasn't willing to remove that thorn. God said to Paul, Paul, you can be a better person with that thorn than without. Because with the thorn, you'll have to know that my grace is sufficient for you and my power is made perfect in weakness. Sometimes our asking doesn't result in the most pleasant responses from God. When we don't know what to ask for, we simply ask with the assurance that God will do what is best. And let me end by saying that, no doubt, God has abundant spiritual riches that he wants to give every one of his children. But he wants to give them in response to asking. And so it's a very simple formula. Askers receive. And those who don't ask do not receive. God gave us prayer to ask for ourselves, among other things, so we would be richly blessed children of God. Let's end with a couple practical suggestions. Just these. First of all, I suggest that you memorize 1 John 5:14-15 and claim the promise every time you pray for the things God wants you to have. Put it up on your mirror or on your steering wheel in the car, wherever you'll see it regularly, and keep claiming that promise that if you ask in accord with his will, he most surely will give you. Second thing is, make your own list of spiritual blessings that are in accord with God's will. As you read the scripture and you run across these things, just write them down, and you'll find the list getting longer and longer, and ask for them regularly, over and over again. And then finally, learn to thank God for the blessings that you ask for, even before you receive them, because you're just so sure that God will keep his promise and give you what you ask. That's an evidence of your faith. So God bless as you ask.